Hi, these are the top 10 films of 1945. When I say top, I mean my personal favourite films. Cheers. In at number 10, The Body Snatcher. The last time Bela Lugosi and Boris Karloff met on screen. Lugosi has a rubbish part as a doomed helper, but Karloff is given time to shine as a grave robber supplying dead bodies for a doctor in 1830s Edinburgh. Based on Robert Louis Stevenson's short story, this is clearly inspired by the real crimes of Burke and Hare, and those two get a few mentions in the screenplay. It's dark, it's twisted, and Karloff gives one of his very best performances as the murderous antagonist.
Tell me plain how they did it.
I'll show you how they did it, Joseph. I'll show you how they burnt them. No! Put your hand down. How can I show you, man? This is how they did it, Joseph.
In a number 9, Blithe Spirit. David Lean adapts another Noel Coward play. This very English film tells the story of a man haunted by his ex-wife. It deals with dark matters in a very light way.
My attitude is that of any normal woman whose husband gets drunk and hurls abuse at her.
I was not drunk!
Quiet, they'll hear you in the kitchen.
I don't care, they hear me in the Folkestone Town Hall. I was not drunk!
Did you call, sir?
No!
There are some tremendous special effects, and the cast give likeable performances, making this an easy Sunday afternoon watch.
Charles, dear, if you weren't drunk, how do you account for it?
I can't account for it. That's what's so awful.
What did you have for lunch?
You ought to know you had it with me.
Let me see. There was lemon sole and that cheese thing.
Why should having a cheese thing for lunch make me see my deceased wife after dinner?
You never know. It was rather rich.
Why didn't you see your dead husband then? You had just as much of it as I did.
This isn't getting us anywhere.
In a number 8, Mildred Pierce. Joan Crawford gives one of her very best performances as a mother trying to do what's best for her children, so a real stretch for the actress. Based on James M. Cain's novel, this dark film has twists and turns and some terrific performances. In a number 7, Pink String and Sealing Wax. One of the first films from the great Robert Hamer. The story follows various people in Brighton around the beginning of the 20th century. Some of the stories are more interesting than others, the best revolving around a landlord's wife who conspires to kill him. My grandmother, Googie Withers, plays the landlord's wife, and this is one of her very best roles. She's fantastic as a backstabbing, manipulative, morally corrupt woman. Nothing like she was in real life. She was a lovely person and a fantastic grandmother. This film appears on Martin Scorsese's list of 50 great British films that he sent to Edgar Wright during the pandemic, which is a list that's well worth working your way through. In at number 6, The Lost Weekend. Billy Wilder's inventive and slightly over-the-top look at a chronic boozer. Ray Milland plays a writer, well at least someone who intends to write. The bottle keeps getting in his way though. The film is full of creative Wilder touches and has some terrific sequences. Alcohol itself is the villain here, and even almost seems to be an otherworldly threat, with its presence signalled by the sound of a theremin. In a number 5, I Know Where I'm Going. The genius filmmaking pair of Powell and Pressburger make this the closest thing to a romantic comedy they ever made. Wendy Hiller plays a headstrong young woman who is engaged to a rich older man. She journeys up to his private Scottish island to marry him, but due to bad weather is stuck on a nearby island. She gets to know the local people, the culture, and meets a down-to-earth real man played by Roger Livesey. Guess what happens? But Powell and Pressburger know how to tell a story, and it's a very charming picture. In a number 4, Rome Open City, one of the first important films in the Italian neorealist movement. Roberto Rossellini directs in the post-war Roman streets, telling the story of life under Nazi rule in the years prior. We follow a group of people, including a priest trying to help a resistance fighter flee the city. It's a violent film with some truly shocking moments.
Francesco! Francesco!
It's a fascinating look at life in Italy during the war, and while being a neo-realist film, it's not particularly realistic. It's melodramatic, with heightened emotions and scenes that get you to feel fear and hatred. Great filmmaking. In a number three, Dead of Night. Possibly the best horror anthology movie of all time. This Ealing Studios film has a group of people in a country house telling each other stories about their run-ins with the supernatural. As with any anthology, some of the stories are stronger than others. The comic relief golfing sequence is the only one that doesn't work, but the two standout segments are the one involving a haunted mirror and my grandmother Googie Withers, and the one starring Michael Redgrave as a man trying to deal with his murderous ventriloquist dummy. Ventriloquist dummies have been used in many horror films, but this is the best example of just how bloody creepy they are. Anthology movies can feel shapeless, but this one has a brilliant ending that wraps up the whole thing in an inventive and frightening way. In a number two, Children of Paradise, one of the greatest French films of all time. Marcel Carné made this 190-minute romantic drama epic during the Nazi occupation of France. Set in Paris during the July Monarchy, we follow five people over the course of several years. At the center of it all is a courtesan played with tenderness and a heavy dose of seduction by Arletty. The other four central characters are very different men who are all in love with her. Marcel Herrand plays a deadly criminal, Pierre Brasseur plays an arrogant actor, and Jean-Louis Barrault plays a mime, about the most French character in the history of cinema. The film mostly takes place in the theater world of Paris. The word paradis can mean the raucous second balcony in a theater, and here we are part of that audience as we watch the drama of these people's lives unfold in front of us. The film is full of romance, but it's really about loss and about giving up the things you love most. It's a tragic film where no one really lives the lives that they want. While being depressing, it's also a riot to watch. It's full of life and humor. Everyone is brilliant in it. The characters are well thought out, and all their choices make sense as well as being dramatically interesting. It's a stunning looking film. You are totally taken back to that time period. There is so much going on in almost every shot. Paris comes alive. You would never think that this was made during a world war. Its influence can be seen in many other directors' work, from Terry Gilliam's to François Truffaut's, which makes it even more tragic that the directors of the French New Wave were so dismissive of Carné's work. With Children of Paradise, he was telling a classic story of love and loss, but also one full of mystery and poetry. Nothing to turn your nose up to. It's heightened reality, one that is totally dreamlike while also being totally relatable. Children of Paradise is a masterpiece. And in a number one, this grounded, minimal film is a beautiful, tragic watch filled with real human emotions. Noel Coward and David Lean once again team up, and this is their greatest collaboration. The non-linear structure is used perfectly to tell this story of an affair between two married people. The title sums up the plot perfectly, and in under an hour and a half we are swept away by this encounter. Celia Johnson and Trevor Howard are exceptional as the ones conducting the affair. There is no glamour to the proceedings. It's about the looks they give one another, knowing that what they are doing is wrong, but being unable to control themselves. It's all done so subtly and realistically that it's riveting on a small scale. There is no need for large conflicts or moments of heightened drama. Just the knowledge that these two people in love cannot be together is enough. It's absolutely heart-wrenching. It's a beautiful looking film, and the use of Rachmaninoff's Piano Concerto No. 2 works a treat, a stunning piece of music that Eric Carmen would use for the base of his pop classic All By Myself. The small English town is created perfectly, and the people surrounding them at the local train station fills the world with life and character. Our protagonists wish they could be alone, but are never given a chance. It's a doomed affair, and before it's even begun, we know it won't work out. There are small lines and looks in this film that can say more than a whole book can about love between people. It's one of the all-time great romantic films, even though it's about two people that never get together. The fact that all things in life are finite are what make them precious, and knowing how brief this encounter will be makes the time they spend together hauntingly touching. It's filmmaking magic, and it required a team this good to make it work. And boy, does it work. Right, so counting down my top 10. In a number 10, The Body Snatcher. In a number 9, Blithe Spirit. In a number 8, Mildred Pierce. In a number 7, Pink String and Sealing Wax. In a number 6, The Lost Weekend. In a number 5, I Know Where I'm Going. In a number 4, Rome, Open City. In a number 3, Dead of Night. In a number 2, Children of Paradise. And in a number 1, Brief Encounter. Well, those are my top 10 films of 1945. What are your top 10 films of 1945? Cheers.